News Channel 5 Network. This is MorningLine with Nick Barris.
Good morning, everyone. Thanks for joining us on MorningLine. Nick Barris here on a Tuesday. As you know, the legislature, it's in action here in Tennessee, and bills are being proposed, and there's several to talk about. Some make more sense than others, I would say. And how many of them are actually going to pass? Well, that all depends. We'll see. Sometimes it depends on which aisle, side of the aisle you sit on. But we're going to talk this morning maybe about more than just this one, but we're going to start off focusing, and I talked about this yesterday. It's almost, to me, a shame that some type of legislation like this needs to be proposed with regard to hungry students and children and the debt and potentially the shaming they may have to deal with to get a lunch, which I didn't even know this could happen, where if you end up having debt for a lunch bill and you're a student going to school, that you might have to stay after school and do things to help pay off that debt or whatever. It's absolutely patently ridiculous. I know someone has to pay for it somehow, but it shouldn't be these students who could potentially go hungry. We're going to talk about that. I guess it's kind of, we'll call it the Tennessee Hunger-Free Student Act, I guess, is part of what it's called, maybe. Is that right? We're going to talk about it with the sponsor of the bill who introduced it. I guess he's got co-sponsors as well. He is a Democrat, so that raises the question of whether or not it will actually have a chance at passing, because this is a Republican-led legislature. But I think this is probably bipartisan support. John Ray Clement, nice to have you on, sir.
Yeah, thanks for having me.
It's a pleasure. Did I get that right? I don't know who would be against this. Now, you've proposed it in past sessions, and it hasn't really moved forward. But first of all, let's just lay out what the problem is and why you think this bill's needed.
Well, this year it's titled the Tennessee Anti-Lunch Shaming Act. That's okay. Universally known as lunch shaming. What the bill is all about is protecting children. Mm-hmm. We don't want children to be stigmatized, discriminated against, or suffer any other unfortunate consequences that could lead to bullying, adverse childhood experiences, or the compounding of adverse childhood experiences like poverty, hunger, all these types of things that our children are experiencing. This bill simply protects the children.
But how are they shamed over lunch?
So what has happened, and there's been news outlets that have reported certain instances, but anecdotally, and I've received emails since introducing this legislation over the past 3 years of many other instances across the state of Tennessee. So we've reported instances in news outlets include children being denied the opportunity to go on field trips. So they're losing an educational opportunity.
Because?
Because they have incurred a meal debt. And a meal debt is no fault of the child. Mm-hmm. We know that. Mm-hmm. This is something the parents are either in a tough situation, they forgot to fill out or didn't know how to fill out their free and reduced meal application, or they're right above the cusp there and they're just having trouble making ends meet, like a lot of families are across Tennessee. So children have been made to eat by themselves in the principal's office. They've had their lunch trays thrown out at when they go up to pay and they have a meal debt. They've had their trays thrown out in front of other students.
Thrown out, but I mean, they're able to get the meal, but then they're billed for it, and then the tab continues to accrue. Is that it? Or are they some of them being denied meals? Like, oh, yeah, you have an outstanding debt, you can't eat today.
Right. So, logistically, what happens generally is they go into the meal line and they get their tray, and then they go to the end, and the person collecting money at the end knows whether or not they have a meal debt, or if they can't pay for their meal at that time, they have it dumped out, or they're told they can't eat because they have a meal debt until they catch up.
There isn't an adult in a school that does something like that.
There are
if I saw that, I would slap them upside the head. That is hard. Don't tell me there is anyone working in a cafeteria anywhere in this school that sees a child with a meal debt, and a meal in most schools is what, $1.50? And they say, oh no, you have a meal debt, and tell this little kid you can't eat and take the food. That does not happen.
It happens.
Well, has someone gone after these people?
No.
If that was my child, or if I saw that happening to someone else's child, it would be all hell breaking loose. I cannot believe that actually happens.
And now you are experiencing the passion with which we're bringing this legislation and the reason for this legislation.
So why hasn't this passed by now?
Well, that's a good question. So last year, the chairman of the House Education Committee said he had a problem with the title of the bill, which, as you read, my former bill was titled Tennessee Hunger-Free Students Act. He didn't like the title of that bill. So this year, I changed the bill to its more common
usage. Is this partisanship? Because that's stupid.
I don't know. I don't want to speculate or cast any stones, but there is no reason. This is not a blue bill. This is not a red bill. This is a bill about protecting children. And the most important thing, we have this whole argument that, oh, somebody has to be held responsible. You know, this is about teaching kids responsibility. And that's feedback that I've received from my colleagues across mm-hmm. the aisle. Well, this bill, this piece of legislation, in no way prevents schools from collecting the debt, because schools are experiencing instances where children are accruing lunch debt, and that money has to be found somewhere. This bill does not prevent schools in any way mm-hmm. from collecting lunch debt from parents or guardians. They can still collect that debt. This sure. bill simply says you cannot punish the child or stigmatize that child in any way. Some students, I received an email yesterday from Upper East Tennessee, up in the Tri-Cities, a child had been made, or all the children, when they had a lunch debt, they would put wristbands on them, and they would write the amount that the child owed on the wristband and go home. So all the other students see this.
Yeah.
It leads to bullying. And just imagine, you know, and I try to tell my colleagues this, you know, put yourself in this child's situation. You're coming from a poor household. You're coming, you know, that's an adverse childhood experience. Extreme poverty is an adverse childhood experience. Hunger is an adverse childhood experience. And then we talk about, we want school children to be able to perform well in our schools. And we know the data is clear. If you're hungry, you cannot perform in school. So why aren't we doing everything that we possibly can to protect these children? We don't want adverse childhood experiences. We want to limit them to the extent that we can within our power. Mm-hmm. Our schools, we have a duty to provide children with a free public education. When they are in those schools, we should be doing everything we can to help them succeed. That includes feeding these children, and it includes not compounding adverse childhood experiences they're experiencing in their community outside those school walls.
Okay, now we did a little bit of research on this. Now, I know Metro Nashville Schools makes it very clear they do not participate in lunch shaming. We talked to Sean Breasted mm-hmm. over there. All children get to eat. He said from 2014 to 2018, a grant program covered the cost of lunch for every Metro.
Absolutely.
Now, in major cities maybe where there are more resources, I'm just guessing that some of this lunch shaming you're talking about is happening more in some of these poorer rural counties perhaps, or is it across the board? It could be just about anywhere.
It's not limited to rural counties. The instances that one was reported in Clarksville, for instance, a few years back.
Okay, they're saying 26 schools across the state, maybe, that's one number, I don't know if you've heard that, have unpaid school lunch balances of more than $200, with some as high as $10,000. And again, I'm going to step back here before, you know, and some people are going to maybe call and say, well, Nick, someone has to pay for it, and I agree. I understand a school is strapped for cash anyway, and they've got $10,000 in outstanding bills. Again, that needs to be addressed either through the parents or through grants. It's just my problem is, I don't care how big the bill is, you don't shame the child. That is patently absurd, wrong, and there's no argument there. If you want to argue otherwise, don't call in, because I don't want to hear from you, I'll hang up on you. You don't shame the child, but it is fair to say someone has to pay for this.
Absolutely. That's why my bill doesn't prevent the school from collecting the debt. They just can't punish the child. They can collect the debt from the parent or guardian.
Okay, now sometimes the parent and guardian just won't pay, so what do you do? I mean,
after them, and they can collect the money, and certain school systems collect the money. What I don't want to see happen, and what my bill does prevent or prohibit, is farming this out to collection agencies that then charge exorbitant fees on top of
the debt.
They'll charge 10%, 15% collection fee. You can hire out a collection agency, but and that's not prohibited by the legislation. What is prohibited are those excessive fees that collection agencies may charge to an already cash-strapped family.
As we go to the break, just off the top of your head then, do we know how many children this could potentially affect, or families that are in this pickle? I mean,
As far as I'm concerned, this bill protects every student in the state of Tennessee, because while some schools may not do this, there is nothing in the law prohibiting them from doing this. Now, they use their better judgment. MNPS uses its better judgment. Many others do. Mm-hmm. But there is currently nothing in the law to say we are not going to lunch shame. We are going to protect children and prevent stigmatization and the compounding of adverse childhood experiences. That's why I want this in the law.
It's just crazy. These are educators and administrators that are trained and have gone to college and learned, and that kind of shaming, whether it's for school lunches or discipline of any type in that way, it's kind of like putting a kid in the corner wearing a dunce cap. I mean, it's absurd. I mean, by today's standards of educational knowledge, that's not what you do. I mean, it's stupid. We're going to take a break. When we come back, we'll take some phone calls, your thoughts on this, and whether you agree or don't agree. If you don't agree with this, boy, I want to hear from you, and you and I are going to go at it. But we'll get more details from the representative as well as we talk about this bill. We may touch on some others as well. We'll be back with more right after this.